We're going to go to Romans chapter 3 and look at a couple of verses here regarding what the cross of Christ does for the Father. This is one of those occasions, because of the cold, that I forgot to double check which verses I chose to read. So can you remind me, maybe display where we're going to start? Okay, verse 21. So let's start in verse 21 and we'll read at least through verse 26, perhaps to the, were we going to the end of the chapter? Okay. All right, so this is what Paul writes to the Romans. But now apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, has been revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by His grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, notice, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in His blood through faith. This was to demonstrate His righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, He passed over the sins previously committed for the demonstration, I say, of His righteousness at the present time, so that He would be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? Of works? No, but by a law of faith. For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is He not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also. Since indeed God, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith, is one. Do we then nullify the law through faith? May it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law. Now, I do realize that sometimes Paul's argumentation in the book of Romans can be somewhat difficult. We're just going to focus on those two verses, verses 25 and 26, again to see how the cross of Christ vindicates the justice of God, how He can forgive even before Jesus came into the world, how He was able to pass over sins that had been previously committed. Now, this morning, as a reminder, we saw that Jesus died and rose again. He died for our sins. Our sins were laid on Him, and He died in our place. He was also raised again for our justification. Death could no longer hold Him in the grave once He had paid our debt. The fact that He was raised from the dead means that we are saved. God's Word tells us that if we believe in Jesus, if we turn from our sins and trust Him, He washes away all of our sins. He clothes us with His righteousness, His perfect obedience. And God declares us to be just, not on the basis of what we have done, but on the basis of what Jesus did in His obedience and in His death. It's on account of these things that we are justified. Now, what we want to see tonight is that we were not the only ones who were actually justified by Jesus' death and resurrection. The Father and the Son were as well, although not in the same way. Here's where we need to be careful. We were sinners that needed vindication. We needed to be freed from the guilt of our sins. We needed a perfect righteousness to inherit eternal life in heaven. We have those things in Christ. In Christ, we are perfect. In Christ, God declares us to be just. But they, on the other hand, essentially wanted to head off any false charges that some might be tempted to make against them for justifying us. The Father, from any charges of injustice, for forgiving the guilty. Remember, God justifies the wicked, those who personally are wicked, but who trust in the Son. We were wicked when we came into the world. We hated God. We wanted nothing to do with him. We were guilty, guilty enough to go into hell. And God gave us the free gift of life through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. How can he do that and be just? And the Son, of course, to be exonerated from any charge that he actually deserved to be on the cross, which is what his enemies were actually saying of him. The resurrection is his justification or his vindication, as we've already read in Romans chapter 1. Well, this evening I want us to consider that the Father was vindicated. His justice was vindicated at the cross. He was justified in that sense. And that the Son was justified at the resurrection. Now, first of all, the Father was justified. He was cleared from any charge that might be brought against him at the cross. And again, I understand how this sounds. It sounds somewhat irreverent, even to suggest that God could ever possibly be charged with anything. I mean, how could the one who is perfectly holy ever do anything wrong? As Abraham said in Genesis 18, verse 25, "Shall not the judge of all the earth deal justly?" Of course, he will. He always will. He can do nothing wrong. But that doesn't mean that someone might not attempt to level a charge against him. Why would they do that? Why would Paul even bring this up? Well, it's because of what God did in the past, before Jesus came, that might have seemed to be unjust, for forgiving without a payment actually having been made. Paul writes in Romans chapter 3, verse 25, "In the forbearance of God, he passed over the sins previously committed." He was overlooking sins, passing them by. He was granting love, mercy, and forgiveness. He was redeeming lost souls. As a matter of fact, if we understand what the Bible says, he was even bringing souls to heaven. And we believe that that's, as a matter of fact, what the Lord was doing. Everyone who trusted him in the old covenant was taken to heaven when they died. Now, how can God do that without proper grounds? How can he do that without adequate payment? At least, again, that's how it may have seemed. Well, God redeemed Adam and Eve, we saw this morning, when they sinned without any payment having yet been made. We read this morning in Genesis 3:15, in his curse on the serpent, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." Now remember that Eve, when she listened to Satan and ate of that tree, sided with Satan. She chose to obey him. She abandoned God and joined herself with the enemy. And when Adam ate of the tree, he did exactly the same thing. But in this curse upon the serpent, God was mercifully bringing the woman back to himself. Notice in Genesis 3:15, he says, "I will put enmity between you and the woman." In other words, I'm going to bring hatred, I'm going to bring animosity between you and, you know, between the serpent and the woman, making Satan again her enemy, and he then becoming her enemy. God redeemed Eve back to himself. There's only two camps. She sided with the enemy and was in his camp, and at that point she was God's enemy. But then God was bringing her back to himself, and she would again become the serpent's enemy. We know that when God made a sacrifice and used the skins to cover Adam and Eve's nakedness, he showed that he was essentially doing the same thing for both Adam and Eve. But the question is this: how could he do that? How could he pass over their sins? Especially on the basis of what seemed to be two creatures that he had sacrificed in their stead. And how could he do that and still claim to be just? There had to be a payment that was valuable enough to cover their debt, but as yet there was no such payment. Now the same thing can be said of every time the Lord shows mercy in the Old Covenant. He showed mercy, of course, to Adam and Eve, as we've seen. He showed mercy to their son Seth, to Noah, to Shem, to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Joshua, Samuel, David, and a host of others. Under the sacrificial system, the Lord was forgiving those who were offering their sacrifices according to the law. The Lord said he forgave them. And yet the author to the Hebrews tells us that those sacrifices that they were offering to God in themselves could not take away sin. The author to the Hebrews says in Hebrews 10 verse 4, "For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." Now, it's easy for us to understand how the Lord, of course, could do this because we live after the cross. We've already seen the vindication of God. Whenever God forgave anyone in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, even all the way back to Adam and Eve, it was always with Jesus' sacrifice in view. When the Lord said he was bringing the woman back into his camp, he said at the same time, again in Genesis 3:15, "I will put enmity between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." The Lord was making a promise that the seed of the woman that was going to come would crush the head of the serpent. He was promising to send his son into the world to destroy the works of the devil by making a payment, which we saw this morning, which was a basis upon which God could forgive. Remember, the only hold that Satan has on us is the fact that we're guilty and under God's wrath, and that's why we're in his kingdom. But when Jesus comes and makes a payment, he releases us from that liability to God's justice, and he redeems us into his kingdom, taking away Satan's hold on us. When God passed over the sins of Adam and Eve, he did it on the basis of that one who was coming. Everyone who believed that promise, or the many other promises that the Lord made throughout the Old Covenant and also through the types and the shadows of the Old Covenant, through the sacrifices, those who were actually able by faith to look ahead and to see that coming seed of the woman who was going to crush the head of the serpent, that coming seed of Abraham through whom all the nations of the earth would be blessed, who could see that God was going to provide a sacrifice that would take away sins as they were offering their sacrifices to him, all those who saw Jesus by faith and trusted him were forgiven on the basis of what Jesus was going to do in the future. But that God was just in forgiving them before Jesus came was not clearly seen until the payment was actually made. So here's the point. It was at the cross that his justice was justified, that his justice was vindicated, that God showed himself to be just in having forgiven and having passed over all those previous sins. Paul tells us that God put Jesus, his sacrifice, by which he satisfied his justice, by which he propitiated or satisfied God, on public display. He didn't allow this to be done in a corner. He did it before many witnesses. As we saw this morning, there were many witnesses to the death of our Lord Jesus Christ as well as his resurrection, so that they would see, and so that we would see as well, that God was just in passing over those sins, because he didn't actually pass over them, but he forgave them with the cross in view. Again, let's read what Paul has to say in light of this in Romans 3, verses 24 and 25. He says, "Being justified is a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation or a satisfaction of his justice in his blood through faith. This was to demonstrate his righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, he passed over the sins previously committed." Paul is telling us that the cross is where God displays his justice, and it vindicates all the mercy and all the grace that he has shown throughout the ages, because Jesus paid for it all. Now, of course, the cross also shows us that God continues to be just in forgiving all who trust in his Son from that time to the present, and even, of course, into the future. Paul continues in verse 26, "For the demonstration, I say, of his righteousness at the present time, so that he would be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus." God was just in forgiving those who trusted Jesus before Jesus came. God was just in forgiving those who actually lived when Jesus died on the cross, he was just in forgiving them, and the Lord continues to be just in forgiving those who trust Jesus after he came, just as the Lord can be just in forgiving us, because Jesus has made a full payment on the cross to his justice. He has forgiven you if you have trusted him. Jesus, as we saw this morning, was the only one who possibly could have made a payment great enough to pay our debt. But since he has made that payment, God may now show us grace. Remember, God is a just God, and God can't simply dismiss sin. He can't simply overlook sin. He can't simply say it doesn't matter. He must punish sin, which is why it would appear that God is unjust unless we actually see that payment made. But we see it made at the cross of our Lord Jesus. So the cross is the vindication of God. And this brings us to our second point, that Jesus also was justified, but in his instance, it was at the resurrection. Now here again, we need to ask the question of what did Jesus possibly need to be vindicated? I mean, after all, he was the spotless and blameless Lamb of God. Throughout his life, he committed no sin. And that certainly is true, but we also need to recognize there were many people who lived at the time of Jesus who looked at him and did not believe that to be true. As a matter of fact, they believed that he was guilty enough to actually be nailed to the cross and that he deserved to die in that way. There were many Jews who thought Jesus was nothing more than a blasphemer because he claimed to be the Son of God and so equal with God. We read in John chapter 5, verses 16 through 18, "For this reason, the Jews were persecuting Jesus because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But he answered them, 'My Father is working until now, and I myself am working.' For this reason, therefore, the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because he was not only breaking the Sabbath, but also was calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." In John chapter 8, verses 56 through 59, Jesus said this to the Jews, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, 'You are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham?' Jesus said to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am.' Therefore, they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple." I think you understand Jesus called himself by the name God, identifies himself. The Lord, Yahweh, essentially means I am. Jesus was calling himself the God of Israel, and they picked up stones to stone him. And then in John 10, verses 31 through 33, the Jews picked up stones again to stone him. Jesus answered them, "I showed you many good works from the Father. For which of them are you stoning me?" The Jews answered him, "For a good work we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself out to be God." Now, it was because of these things that when Jesus was crucified, the Jews, when they, of course, called out for his blood and saw him on the cross, they believed that Jesus was simply getting what he deserved. Remember what we read this morning in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 27, verses 39 through 43. "And those passing by," that is Jesus, while he was nailed on the cross, "were hurling abuse at him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now, if he delights in him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" Now, the fact that Jesus was on the cross in their minds proved to them that he was under God's curse. Remember what Paul tells us in Galatians 3:13. "Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree.'" Now, essentially, when the Jews saw Jesus on the cross, they realized that he was cursed by God, and they believed that he deserved to be cursed because of what he said, because he blasphemed. And Jesus actually had become a curse, and that's why he was hanging on the tree, but it wasn't for any sin he had committed. He was absolutely blameless. It was for the sins we had committed, for everyone who trusts in him. Those sins were imputed to him, and he became a curse for us, as we just read in Galatians 3:13. But how could that be proven? How could that be demonstrated? How did the Father actually prove that Jesus was whom he claimed to be? Well, he did it actually in several ways, all of which had to do with the ministry of the Holy Spirit, which shouldn't surprise us, especially having listened to Sinclair Ferguson teach us about the Spirit. But Paul writes in 1 Timothy 3:16, "By common confession, great is the mystery of godliness. He who was revealed in the flesh was vindicated or justified in the Spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, taken up in glory." Now, Paul here is clearly talking about Jesus, the one who was revealed in the flesh. Paul says he was vindicated, and again, this is the same word that is translated also justified. He was declared to be blameless in the Spirit. So the question is, how did the Spirit justify, vindicate the Lord Jesus? Well, he actually did it in at least three ways. I'm sure there's more than that, but at least three ways. First of all, he did it in Jesus' ministry. Remember, Jesus was anointed with the Spirit of God above measure. Jesus did what he did in the power of the Holy Spirit, and what he did were the things that were predicted Messiah would do. The Spirit of God empowered him to do these things. Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 3. "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant those who mourn in Zion, giving them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a spirit of fainting. So they will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." Now, Jesus did what it is Isaiah predicted, or what the Lord actually said through Isaiah the Messiah would do. And he did these things in the power of the Holy Spirit. And when he was doing these things, the Spirit of God was vindicating or justifying his claim to be the Messiah, to be the Son of God. The second way the Spirit of God did this was on the day of Pentecost. The fact that the Spirit was poured out on that day was proof that Jesus was who he claimed to be, and that he was where he claimed to be, which was in heaven, because the outpouring of the Holy Spirit is what Jesus had promised once he had been exalted. Peter preached in Acts chapter 2, verses 32-33 on the day of Pentecost, He says, this Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit was the evidence that Jesus was no liar, but he was who he claimed to be. And then finally, for our purposes this evening, the Spirit of God vindicated Jesus by raising him from the dead. And here's where we get back to our meditation. Paul writes in Romans 1, verses 1 through 4, Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord. The resurrection was one of these three ways, but a very powerful way, in which the Spirit of God vindicated Jesus' claim to be the Son of God. He declared him to be the Son of God with power by raising him from the dead. God can forgive us, as we've seen, and he can be just because of the cross of Christ. It vindicates the justice of God in his mercy and his grace and in his forgiving us. And we can know through the resurrection that our sins have been paid for in full by the only one who could have paid for them, because the resurrection declares that Jesus is the Son of God, the only one who could possibly discharge our debt. And so, do you want to know that your sins are forgiven? There's only one way that you can, and that is by looking to the cross. God can forgive because of Jesus' payment. And of course, to look to the resurrection, because as we saw this morning, the resurrection is the proof that God the Father received the payment, that the payment for our sins was made in full. Jesus proved himself to be the Son of God, and he has discharged our debt. If you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You will never die because of what Jesus has done. So on this day, again, as we think about the death of our Lord Jesus Christ, as we think about his resurrection, let's remember, of course, what it means regarding God's justice and regarding Jesus' claims. But let's also remember what it means to us. These events really took place. The Lord really did these things for us and our salvation. And because Jesus died and because he was raised again from the dead, we, if we have trusted in him, are saved. And we will see heaven. And actually, that's I think it's a very good thing to think about, particularly as we prepare to come to the Lord's table. Because this reminds us, as we've just seen and on numerous occasions before, of the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus says, do these things in remembrance of me, that I loved you and laid down my life for you. And of course, the Lord's Day is the day that Jesus rose again from the dead, the first day of the week. And of course, the fact that it's Easter Sunday, this particular Sunday, our attention is drawn perhaps even more fully to the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. Jesus died and was raised so that all who are trusting in him will be saved. If we turn from our sins and trust in him, we will be saved from our sins. So let's take just a couple of moments and let's bow in silent prayer and let's ask the Lord to prepare us to come to his table, that we might remember his death, and that we might also know that in the death of Christ, we were saved. Let's spend a few moments again in prayer.